the thing about us is anytime we're around a guitar or a piano or anything, we're playing, we're writing. You know, anytime you pick up a guitar, a song could come out, so that's writing. But especially on the road is something we've always done, get together at soundcheck and make noise, or riding down the highway on the bus, you play your guitar, and we came up with all kind of stuff. 11 months, you better come up with some.
Okay.
All right, so why don't you tell me where we are, where we're going?
Are we recording here?
Yeah.
This is the studio, front door. We're going in. It's a no smoking building. Come on in.
Check the studio. Well, I'm
right. You're right. You're rolling.
Ready?
Get in. Get in. Get in.
We roll.
1, 2, 1, 2.
Welcome to MTV News Raw, our Edit Light interview series, where this time around we feature R.E.M., who have just signed a new record contract with their label Warner Brothers in the neighborhood of $80 million, a figure that surpasses the industry's previous top contract, Janet Jackson's reported $70 million Virgin Records deal. With their future now secure, R.E.M. can focus on the present, which includes the release of their 10th album, New Adventures in Hi-Fi, written mostly on the road during the band's eventful 1995 world tour for their last record, Monster. After a brief break, they headed into the recording studio, this time working at Seattle's famed Bad Animals studio, where we caught up with them this past spring and shot this exclusive interview with Michael Stipe and some raw studio performance footage as well.
Okay, thank you.
So, you have speed?
Speed.
Have you guys done this before, where you've let camera crews into the studio?
Yeah, I think we did it for Automatic for the People. Because we weren't doing interviews for that record. And it was one way to, you know, kind of let people see, you know, what we look like and what we were working. Something, you know, the record didn't just fall out of the sky. You know, there was a little something to nail it to.
Is the environment of a studio something that you find inspiring or stimulating?
Different studios have different good and bad qualities. The two that we've worked on in the last couple of years, Criteria in Miami and the studio in New Orleans, which is in a house that was built in the 1810s. Yeah, but it's run by a woman named Karen Brady, who's
right.
Really an incredible person. And those studios are, you know, they're amazing for their atmosphere and you know, it's a really inspired kind of vibe, if you will. Bad Animals doesn't necessarily have that same atmosphere and vibe, but it does have some good qualities, some very good qualities.
In terms of the...
Well, the people that work here are tremendous. It's kind of great to work in Seattle. You can walk across the street, get your laundry done, get a double shot, short soy cappuccino in the space of a minute and a half,
mm-hmm.
You know. And
although
the studio is a little bit sterile, you know, we were able to dress it up with Christmas lights and stuff like that, make it a little bit more, you know, conducive to creative
Scott was
work.
Saying that this particular room is left over from the 70s. You can
yeah,
tell
the cork.
From the nice cork, and this is where Barracuda was recorded.
Yeah, I like that, though. I mean, Criteria is the same way, you know. The thing about Bad Animals, it's really good, it's really great, is, you know, it's got a tradition of some really fine records that have been made here. People that work here are tremendous, and they've got really good equipment.
Can you give me a rundown of what a typical day has been like over the last 2 months for you?
Yeah, I get up, stop moving. I like to move when I'm being interviewed.
I'm not going to be in a stool.
A typical day, I'll get up around 11, have some coffee, and, you know, maybe go swim somewhere or walk to work, and get to the studio around 1 o'clock, and we work until 11 officially, but sometimes it goes till 2 or 3 in the morning.
But that whole time you're not singing?
No. I mean, you don't walk in and just sing and play. There's a lot of technology that you have to kind of hurdle.
Are most of the songs already written?
They are. As you know, we recorded a lot of stuff on the road. Sound checks. One of the songs was recorded on the back of a bus while it's moving, and we're just kind of adding things here and there, taking things away, experimenting with different ideas.
The songs that I heard yesterday made I thought your voice on the songs that I heard yesterday sounds more natural than Monster, for instance. There weren't as many effects, and it wasn't as distorted. Is that something that's consistent throughout the other songs as well, or is that too much of a generalization?
No, that's actually... With Monster, I was singing through Walkman. We were putting all kinds of effects on the vocals, and it just kind of the vocal was treated like a fuzz bass guitar, really, for a lot of that record. And for this record, for whatever reason, the songs that those guys have written, the keys that they're in, the key or the melody that I come up with, is something that I really like the way my voice is resonating. Just straight into the microphone, so we haven't really felt the need to dress it up any.
But it also sounds like you're singing in a very classic way.
I am.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm so in the middle of this that I have no objectivity whatsoever.
Especially in the Leper song.
New Test Leper. I like that song a lot.
Your producer, Scott Litt, said that he can't remember a time that you were this excited about making a record.
We're all really excited about this record. It's really true.
Do you know why?
I'm thrilled by the material. I certainly...
But don't you always go into the studio thinking you have good songs?
Always think it's the best record, but there's something, there's something going on here that I think is really pretty great.
When we return, we'll look back with the band on the triumphs and travails of their 1995 world tour.
We roll!
1, 2, 1, 2.
It's really easy to register to vote. I think it's really important.
I think the thing in the greatest jeopardy right now is a woman's reproductive freedom.
I mean, you know, vote for whoever you want to. I don't care, but... It just seems really weird that we're going to spend more on bombs and less on children.
And with us right now, the band is looking both ways before they cross the street. R.E.M., how are you guys doing?
Hey, Tabitha, we're doing good.
Michael, you're the most recent surgery victim. How you feeling?
You want to see it?
Yeah.
I can show it to you.
Show me, baby. You got your ID bracelet on still?
Yeah.
Get a close-up, guys.
This will take a while, so you can talk.
Anybody else want to show their surgery scars? Oh, there we go. Very nice. Thank you. Okay, you can put that up now.
Check with Steve. Well, I have a mic to turn into
the right. You
ready?
You have some questions? We roll.
1, 2, 1, 2.
3, 2, 1. R.E.M. has never been particularly fond of touring, and one might think that after some of the medical pitfalls suffered on their last tour, including drummer Bill Berry's near-fatal brain aneurysm, the band would have sworn off the practice forever. Still, they forged on, and during that tour managed to write most of the material for the new album and even record some tracks as well.
When you look back at, on the tour, now that you've had time to reflect, what are your impressions?
I'm still on tour. I mean, that's a shocking thing, is, you know, that 4 months after our last show, you know, we're making an album. But there was a stomach growling in the room. So there was a, I think there was an immediacy. There was something that we didn't want to lose, the momentum of touring. We didn't want to lose the excitement of being on the road and what these songs were. We didn't want to sit and rest too long before we went in to make the record, so that the songs would be fresh to us, and we'd go in with an attitude that eventually come out with a record that reflected that.
Do you look back at the tour as something that was a lot of fun?
It was a lot of fun, yeah. There were, you know, obvious potholes along the way, but we made it.
Do you want to do it again after this record?
Don't want to tour on it? No.
It wasn't that fun.
No, I mean, I don't want to tour, not for a while. But I expect that we will.
Do you have any lasting repercussions from your hernia? You don't have to show me your scar.
No, everybody's seen it.
Sorry.
Just, you know, in defense of myself, I was on painkillers the whole time that I was showing my scar to the world. And
you're off the painkillers
now? I'm glad
now?
That everyone now knows. Well, I needed something, some kind of sympathy, you know. Yeah, I'm off the painkillers.
But it hasn't affected your singing, or you don't get your voice more strained or physically tired?
No, it hasn't. It's kind of like when the weather changes and you got a bad knee and you can feel it in your bones or whatever. That kind of happens. So I know if the weather's going to change. But apparently that goes away after a year.
And how about Bill? Since I didn't interview him, I just realized I haven't. Is there any effect from him having an aneurysm still? Does he have to do?
No,
he's perfectly.
He's better off than we are, because he will never have an aneurysm. They made it so that it can never happen to him. No, he's fine. Don't anyone ever come up to me in a bar again and ask me if Bill's okay. We all appreciate your concern, but he's really fine.
I mean, you know, there wasn't like a single light beer left. I just tore through it.
Never really. Okay. So last time, let's see. I guess at the end of last year, there were serious rumors about you taking a year off after a tour. I mean, the tour was pretty grueling. What made you go back into the studio so quickly?
You know, I think we're at the age as a band and as people that doing the work and putting it across and getting it done is really important. And I just didn't feel like taking a year off. I think that we're working really well, and we'd written all these songs on the road, 17 or 18 of them, and it just didn't make any sense to just wait a year to record them just on general principles. I mean, I could take a year off when I'm 50 and nobody will care. You know, I mean, I won't be needed then. You know, I'll be playing summer holiday camps or whatever you do when your career's over. So for us, it just felt like a great thing. We've got these songs. We feel real strongly about recording them. Let's just go in and do it.
And tell me about the process of writing songs on the road. Is that common for R.E.M.?
Well, we write songs everywhere. I mean, you know, we write songs when we're waiting for airplanes. And so on the road, it's just another place. We've always done it. The first 10 years of our career, for lack of a better word, we were on the road all the time, so we kind of had to write on the road. This time, the one thing we did is we wanted to kind of write all these songs that make a body of work that kind of reflects what the on-the-road experience is without being about hotel rooms and bad food and airplanes and, you know, this kind of Deep Purple I'm on the road again songs.
Yeah.
You know, Deep Purple can do that. And we just wanted to kind of capture the kind of insanity and the weirdness and the alienation and the total upside-down aspect of life by writing them on the road and recording them on the road. So we actually did that. Most of the songs were recorded on 8-track at sound checks or during the shows.
It's not... I'll say, this is what's happening, what's your opinion? In terms of your approach to the recording process, bringing all the different parts with you from the road, stuff from your bus and the dressing room and sound check, Does the album sound all over the place? I mean, can you tell where it was recorded when you listen to it?
No, it's more just a feel thing. It's a very intangible, you know, the desire to keep a track, say, that we recorded on the bus. You're not supposed to be able to listen to it and go, wow, that sounds like something I did in the back of a bus. But there's a feel to it, hopefully, that you can capture that's looser. You know, you're
immediate.
Not regimented. It's yeah, more spontaneous and immediate, and just more relaxed. The feeling of the song comes through maybe because you're not trying so hard to keep it in time. You're just doing it. And you know, with same thing with the dressing room stuff. And that's why you want to do that. It's not to make a lo-fi record necessarily, but just to keep some sort of spontaneity in mind.
When you look back on the tour, now that you've had time to reflect on it, what are your impressions?
It was great. I mean, I loved it. You know, life sort of made itself known on the road, and it was a microcosm.
Be
of
more
a,
specific.
Well, it was
than
sort
that.
Of a microcosm of an entire life. I mean, people get sick, you know, but there's little babies on it as well. You know, it's like, and like I said, it was just an encapsulation of an entire lifetime in 1 year. It felt like, and I enjoyed the hell out of it.
More on the new record and working in Seattle when MTV News Raw continues.
We roll.
1, 2, 1, 2.
This is a double shot short soy cap. You have to say short in Seattle. Check
it out. Well, I'm like this time in GB, right?
You're rolling.
Ready?
You have a list of questions? We roll.
1, 2, 1, 2.
R.E.M.'s latest effort, New Adventures in Hi-Fi, once again features Michael Stipe's lyrical social commentary, which he was reticent to talk about during our interview because he was still in the process of writing the lyrics. But the singer was eager to talk about the city where the album was recorded and its attractions.
We should talk about Seattle some, because
sure,
I can throw around some names.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, what have you been doing in Seattle while you've been here?
Well, I've been working mostly. But that being said, you know, there's been... I mean, there's so much kind of exciting music going on here.
Have you seen a lot of good bands?
I saw Yoko Ono perform, and I've seen a number of local bands play. I'm going to go see Hovercraft tomorrow night. I'm excited about that.
Wow. And that, of course, is Eddie Vedder's band. Have you seen...
Actually, Beth.
Beth and him, or just Beth?
I think it's Beth's band. Is that right? Yeah.
Oh, I've only seen them, both of them play together with that.
It's been really great, though. I mean, part of being the band Animals, you know, Soundgarden have recorded here, Alice in Chains and Nirvana. And
have you
all those guys are in town, and they come by. The guy from Alice in Chains came by and gave us candles, you know.
Jerry Cantrell? Or
Mike is his
Inez.
Name. Mike Inez, yeah. He's a really sweet guy. And Kim's been around from Soundgarden and Chris. And, you know, we've seen Chris Novoselic. And it's just been kind of great to be in a town where, you know, there's people that we respect. They do the same thing we do. They drop by... You know,
are any of them
for encouragement
ending up on the record?
Some of them, yeah. It's not done yet, so
right.
We'll see.
No,
largely.
Right.
This guy Barrett from Scott.
Right, we got that one.
Yeah. And Scott McCoy from Young Fresh Fellows.
Is that affecting your work at all, or is it just nice because it's, you know, more social and it? But it's not like it's inspiring the music or pulling it in a certain direction.
Well, no, it kind of it's not, certainly not pulling it in any direction, but it's really great to be in a place where people who do the same thing that you do and who know what you like the head that you're in or the space that you're in when you record, because it's a very specific kind of weirdness.
Well, wasn't Los Angeles like that?
Yeah, but Los Angeles is different, a different universe altogether.
Because can't that also be distracting, having people stop by all the time?
It can't. Well, they're not stopping by all the time. It's just, it's inspiring, you know. And it's great because you feel, you know, you kind of have the privacy that it takes to make a record, but you also have people who do the same thing that you do.
And, right. Feel like there's a community there.
They're encouraging it makes you feel like part of a community. It's important.
Tell me about another show that you recently went to see. It was Patti Smith. Can you tell me why... she was important to you?
I wrote a letter to a friend of mine who's a photographer, and I was describing the show, and I've seen Patti Smith perform several times now. The show that we witnessed at at the Wiltern Theater was, I think, one of my top 10 life experiences. I can say that, you know.
Not even top 10 concerts.
Not even top 10 musical experiences.
Wow.
There was something going on that night, and you know, a lot of it was her performance. A lot of it was just, it was one of those nights. The crowd was there was energy and a buzz going in the crowd that was really undeniable and magical. And she, you know, she is a consummate performer. She's unbelievably great at what she does. And that night, it just came together in such a way.
How about, are there any lyrical themes? Obviously on Monster, there were some definite themes that kept popping up in the different songs. Are there?
Well, again, it's like, I don't know.
Not done yet?
Maybe fear and anxiety and death again. We're making another death record. I don't know. I don't really know. Again, I mean, part of doing what we do is not examining too closely what we're doing while we're doing it.
Okay.
That makes sense, right?
Well, this is, yeah, it does.
It's up to other people to examine and look at, you know, if they want to look at music academically or intellectually. It's up to us to try not to do that, because when you do that, you kind of make bad records. You write bad songs. You get too serious.
Have the songs that you played on stage transformed much in the studio?
Actually, no. They a lot of them. We wound up using sound checks, and I'm sure the other guys told you that, right?
Right.
So they're not unlike how they were on stage. They might be a little bit wilder, actually, because we have the time to experiment with different things and, you know, bring instruments in and out, but we're certainly not going for a live sound particularly. I might be contradicting Peter or someone else. We're not necessarily, in my opinion, what we're doing is somehow synthesizing studio and live together, like cross-grafting the two in a way that, you know, you can't necessarily see the seams.
Mm-hmm.
That's how I'm thinking of the record and
how it
sounds.
You're not contradicting anyone.
Okay, good.
I just realized, though, there is a possibility for that, isn't
it? Well, it happens a lot, and I mean, that's part of the dynamic of R.E.M. That's part of the beauty of it, is that two of us can be looking at exactly the same thing and
right.
see something totally different. And you know, where those two meet, and you double that by two, where those four meet is the little magic DMZ zone that makes R.E.M. R.E.M.
Well, good. Okay. Thanks.
Thank you very much.